There's plenty of buzz around Zero Trust as a framework or a model to improve security in products and in organizations. And this is for good reason. Attackers are targeting identities and legitimate credentials. It is this concept of logging in versus hacking in. But I'd like to set some context around what exactly Zero Trust is. It is all about the ability to continuously verify identities and access controls. It shifts us away from traditional perimeter-based security approaches. Zero Trust assumes that no device or user should be trusted for network access. So with that in mind, the big change is the need to authenticate and authorize every access request from every user, application, or device. In addition, Zero Trust creates the need for micro-segmentation of the network. It also creates the need for us to adopt policies of least privilege access. That is, the ability to provide access only to the data that you need to do your job when you need it. Through Zero Trust, we look to continuously verify the trust levels of users, devices, and applications. Now, one thing we don't talk about as much when we talk about Zero Trust is the fact that it shifts the emphasis to protecting data, as opposed to protecting users, applications, and devices. So what exactly does this mean for backup and recovery environments? For years now, we've seen that backup systems have been a favorite target of attackers. This is not necessarily surprising, because of course, backup and recovery environments are critical to recovering from an attack. So with that in mind, backup and recovery environments also cannot be exempt from Zero Trust practices. In fact, what we're seeing is that the need to embrace Zero Trust is creating new table stakes criteria within backup and recovery environments. These include adoption of these least privilege access policies that we've been talking about. It also creates the need for contextual, fine-grained access controls within the backup and recovery environment. We're seeing that multi-factor authentication and the four eyes principle, which is the need for potentially destructive actions to be authorized by two administrators, have become table stakes. We see that regular auditing and continuous monitoring of the backup environment system's read and access requirements becomes necessary. With Zero Trust, we see that there is more continuous monitoring for anomalies and threat detection, because we unfortunately must assume that the threat actors may get in. Now, with that in mind, there's another couple of capabilities that we see become table stakes. One is the ability to have segmentation within the backup and recovery environment. This includes data isolation or air gapping practices. Sometimes these are referred to as practices of data vaulting. This prevents lateral movement within the environment in the event that an attacker gets in. Also, best practices around immutability and encryption become non-negotiable because these inhibit the ability to tamper with data if an attacker does penetrate the environment. There's a strong need within Zero Trust for ongoing levels of system resilience, as well as more flexible recovery options. This is because in a Zero Trust architecture, recovery processes become very complicated. User identities and user privileges are fluctuating. The network includes micro-segmentation, and the conditions are very dynamic. And we also see that data is segmented and distributed, typically across hybrid multi-cloud environments. So that creates the need to more regularly test and validate the effectiveness of backups and recovery procedures, as well as any potential vulnerabilities within these backup and recovery procedures. It also creates more of a need for broader incident response planning and testing as well. What exactly does it look like for data to be resilient with Zero Trust principles? As we were talking about, we see that data tends to be distributed across multiple locations and systems in order to reduce the risk of a single point of failure. Naturally, granular access controls become very important in order to limit the access to data and minimize the potential impact of a breach. Immutable storage and encryption, as we talked about, become necessary in order to prevent unauthorized modification or deletion. Naturally, we do need our regular backups in the event that we do require recovery, as well as more extensive planning and testing around disaster recovery. This is in order to ensure that data can be quickly restored in the event of a major incident. We see that backup and recovery environments become monitored on a regular basis for threats and anomalies to allow for earlier detection and response, and that our backup and recovery processes and plans need to be regularly tested and ultimately flow into broader incident response plans in order to address these security breaches more comprehensively and effectively. Successful implementation of Zero Trust concepts brings a number of key benefits to backup and recovery environments. Primarily, these include the ability to minimize security risks by reducing the attack surface and ensuring that stringent access control across all environments. So again, this reduces the attack surface, it prevents lateral movement of threats, and it ultimately limits the impact of a successful breach. One key area of opportunity that I see with Zero Trust is the ability to bridge the long-standing gap that exists between IT and security teams. Historically, these teams have existed in a silo, and typically they have not engaged until there is an emergency. This does remain a problem, because it takes time to change habits like these that are very long-standing. But what Zero Trust does is it provides a common goal and a vision to get there. It nurtures shared responsibility between these two teams, as well as a more proactive approach between these two teams when it comes to areas such as identifying and addressing risks and vulnerabilities, implementing and maintaining security controls as well. It really nudges IT and security teams more towards communication and information sharing because they are both working to implement, manage, and refine these Zero Trust architectures on an ongoing basis. Again, there's still plenty of work to be done in this area, but Zero Trust can potentially help because what it does is it puts frameworks and best practices in place that can help to truly facilitate that day-to-day collaboration. Now, looking ahead over the next 5 years, naturally, we do expect Zero Trust to evolve. Notably, one of the big areas is the areas of policies of least privilege access. We do expect that these will become more important. With that in mind, we expect that data classification will also become more important. This is because it helps us to understand and manage the sensitivity and the value of various data. This can then be used to ensure that the appropriate levels of security controls are then applied. Additionally, data classification helps us to prioritize protecting and recovering the most sensitive data in our environment. This can be particularly useful when it comes to preventing data exfiltration. Additionally, data classification can not only inhibit access to sensitive data, but it also can facilitate logs of who had access to what data and when in the event that a breach has occurred. So I know that Veeam has been working alongside experts in the space to ensure that Zero Trust data resilience is possible for all of its customers. I certainly look forward to hearing more about this.